in Sanskrit, Bhagavati Prajna Paramita Hridaya. In Tibetan, Chomden Dema Shera Pachin Ningbo. In English, the Blessed Lady Buddha, Heart of Transcendent Wisdom. Thus did I hear on a special occasion, the Blessed Lord was dwelling on the vulture peak at Rajagriha, together with great communities of mendicants and bodhisattvas. At that time, the Blessed Lord entranced himself in the teaching samadhi called Illumination of the Profound. Just then, the noble bodhisattva Avalokiteshvara, the great hero, was contemplating the practice of the profound transcendence of wisdom, and he realized that those five body-mind processes are void of any intrinsic reality. Thereupon, impelled by the power of the Buddha, Venerable Shariputra addressed the noble bodhisattva Avalokiteshvara, the great hero, thus, "When any noble son wishes to engage in the practice of the profound transcendence of wisdom, how should he learn?" Then the noble bodhisattva Avalokiteshvara, the great hero, addressed Venerable Sharadatiputra thus, "Shariputra, when any noble son or noble daughter wishes to engage in the practice of the profound transcendence of wisdom, he or she should realize it in this way. Those five body-mind processes should be truly realized to be void of any intrinsic reality. Matter is voidness, voidness is matter. Voidness is not other than matter, neither is matter other than voidness. Likewise, sensations, conceptions, mental functions, and consciousnesses are also void. Shariputra, thus all things are voidness, signless, uncreated, unceased, stainless, impeccable, undecreased, and unincreased. Shariputra, thus in voidness there are no matter, no sensation, no conception, no mental function, no consciousness, no eye, no ear, no nose, no tongue, no body, no mentality, no form or color, no sound, no scent, no taste, no texture, no idea. There are no sense media from eye to mentality sense media, and there are no consciousness media from visual to mental consciousness media either. There are no ignorance and no cessation of ignorance and so on up to no old age and death, and no cessation of old age and death either. Likewise, there are no suffering, no origination, no cessation, no path, no intuitive wisdom, no attainment, and no non-attainment either. Therefore, Shariputra, because the bodhisattva is without attainment, he lives in reliance on transcendent wisdom. His spirit is unobscured and free of fear. Passing far beyond all confusion, she ultimately succeeds in nirvana. And all the Buddhas who live in past, present, and future rely on transcendent wisdom to reach manifestly perfect Buddhahood and unexcelled perfect enlightenment. Such being so, there is the mantra of transcendent wisdom, the mantra of great science, the unexcelled mantra, the uniquely universal mantra, the mantra that eradicates all suffering. It is not false and should be known as truth, the transcendent wisdom mantra, as follows: Tadyata. Om gate gate para gate para sam gate bodhi swaha. Om gate gate para gate para sam gate bodhi swaha. Om gate gate para gate para sam gate bodhi swaha. Shariputra, thus should the bodhisattva, the great hero, learn the profound transcendence of wisdom. Thereupon the Blessed Lord arose from that samadhi and applauded the noble bodhisattva Avalokiteshvara, the great hero. "Excellent, excellent, noble son, so it is, so it is. One should practice the profound transcendence of wisdom in just the way you have taught it, and even the transcendent Buddhas will joyfully congratulate you." When the Blessed Lord had spoken thus, the Venerable Sharadatiputra, the noble bodhisattva Avalokiteshvara, the great hero, everyone in that audience and the whole world with its gods, humans, titans, and fairies rejoiced and all applauded what the Buddha said.
All right.
Okay, sure.
You can start each right. day that way now. Oh, good morning. And it's a new year, isn't that incredible? Has anyone written a check yet with 2016 on it? I wrote an offering to the staff here. It was my last tax-deductible donation of 2015. So I thought, oh, this is my last time writing a check with 2015 on it. Maybe not, actually, because one forgets, but I just find it so interesting. I get so exhilarated and I feel so hopeful, even though it is, as I said in the beginning, it's a totally manufactured event. I mean, there's nothing inherent in that transition, but it feels like a transition. And so that's kind of exciting. So I'm excited to go back to New York City and keep working on my book. And hopefully if we're together next year, I won't have to say, I'm going to finish my book soon, referring to the same book. That's my hope. But speaking of my book, the title is Real Love, and I'm continually seeking stories and anecdotes and epiphanies and experiences. If you have anything you'd like to share about love for yourself, love for an other, love for all beings, love for life, anything at all, you can just... I think there's actually an email address, reallove@sharonsalzberg.com. And I always tell people, as is true, I always ask permission before I use someone's name and even their first name. And if you'd rather not have your name, if the story goes there, you know, goes in the book, and you'd rather not have your name with it, then I always let people choose their own pseudonym, which is kind of always an interesting process too. See, what would your name be if you could choose your name right now? It's kind of fun. So that's the book. And while we're on kind of that level, my website is sharonsalzberg.com. And many people have asked me about my schedule in different ways, and it's on there. I am teaching, for those of you from New York, close by, I am teaching four Tuesday nights at Tibet House this month. I'm also, Bob can say something more about this 17-part series. Again, I'm teaching one night, one Wednesday night at Tibet House. I'm teaching at this place called New York Insight. It's my winter, once again, in New York. And I'm sure my schedule is on through many months, much of which will be in New York City, but not all of it. So, as I said, I'm escaping to Miami toward the end of January in North Carolina and in February for brief periods.
You're going to be in North Carolina in February?
Yeah.
Where?
Toward Wilmington, North Carolina. I didn't know there was such a place. Yeah. I am a giant advocate of daily practice, of whatever kind that turns out to be. I was actually teaching at Tibet House one Tuesday night, and somebody rather uncharmingly said to me, a lot of younger meditation teachers, younger than you, say you don't really have to have a formal practice, because of course you can be mindful doing anything. You can bring forth these values in any activity, and that of course is true. But I said in response from my dotage, you know, that is theoretically true. And one of the great Tibetan lamas I studied with in terms of daily manifestation and expression of these values, like mindfulness and compassion, he said, you can see the goal in your daily life as short moments many times. Short moments many times of kind of recollecting. Short moments many times of seeing more deeply. Short moments many times of remembering what's really going to make me happy in this situation, or what about compassion in this moment? So it's short moments many times. So that I really do appreciate. And at the same time, I feel like in a busy, hectic, responsible, kind of crazy world that most of us we describe our day as being part of, how are we going to remember? You know, even that little exercise that I've talked about several times, don't pick up the phone on the first ring. Let it ring three times and breathe. How are you going to remember, you know, when the phone is ringing? But if you have a daily practice, you are so much more likely to remember. It not only is its own kind of strength training, resilience training for that period of time, but it's what creates the platform for then being able to truly, not just hypothetically or glibly, have short moments many times, you know, to do that. What you practice, what form you practice, how long you practice, these are big variables. And, you know, it needn't and shouldn't feel like something, it's not a task, you know, and something sort of grim and laborious, but what an incredible thing that we can just step back from all the normal pressures and conventions and really have nothing to do for that period except strength and awareness and compassion. Like, think of that. And it really takes the, I think, pretty continual exercise of that to begin to see any kind of difference. People always ask, like, how long? Mm-hmm. And it's one of the really fun things in neuroscience these days, or as people are studying meditation through whatever means. You know, everyone's looking for the dose response. Like, is it better to do 10 minutes a day or three intervals of 3.5 minutes a day? Or it's like aspirin, you know? What's the optimal dose? And, you know, people say, I've heard everything from, you know, 20 minutes a day will change your brain. 10 minutes a day over 2 months will change your brain. Half an hour will change your brain. And I mean, change your brain is almost like shorthand for some measurable result that people are looking for, to have some sense of, oh yeah, this is making a difference. So I was at a gingerbread house decorating party a few years ago in Washington. You can actually see my gingerbread house on my Twitter account. I made a loving kindness house. In gumdrops on half the roof it says, may all, and the other half it says, be happy. Someone who I didn't know but who knew me came and sat down right next to me. And she said, can't you get anything out of 5 minutes of meditation a day? So I asked a scientist friend, and she wrote back to me and said, this was a couple of years ago, and I am mostly, I think, identified in the eyes of the world as someone who especially teaches loving kindness. So the scientist friend wrote to me and she said, you'll be happy to hear that the latest study showed that 9 minutes of mindfulness a day and only 7 minutes of loving kindness a day will change your brain. So, I don't particularly practice thinking, oh, I'm changing my brain. And I don't know that it's that healthy to go for the bare minimum. Like, okay, I clocked it, you know, 7 minutes. But there's something about the doing of it, which is, that's the magic, that's the alchemy. It is so much easier to think about and suggest to others and admire from afar than it is to actually do it, to put it into practice, to breathe life into it, no matter what it feels like, and it will feel many different ways. Sometimes our concentration is very strong and we feel the power of all that kind of seemingly random energy coming together. And they're extraordinary, kind of beautiful states of consciousness. that are available. Sometimes it's really rough. We're going through something in our life, or something's happened to a friend, or for whatever reason, it could be kind of mysterious. It's just time for a sort of upheaval, you know, for an arising of some very difficult feelings. And this is not a bad experience at all. Being able to be in touch with our own pain is considered the basis both for a very priceless kind of ethics, you know, that isn't moralistic and it isn't preachy, but it's like conscience, you know. You feel so acutely, and as you're about to tell a lie to this person, you remember kind of what it was like, what it felt like when it was me, you know, and how overlooked I felt and unseen I felt and disregarded I felt, and you kind of shrink back from inflicting that. And that being in touch with one's own pain is also the foundation for empathy. I mean, if we're blocked, if we're cut off, if we can't resonate with our own difficult states, how will we resonate with the difficult state of someone else? So even though these experiences are difficult, they are useful, they're important. They're in no way bad. Of course, we don't like them. And for many of us, our very strong cultural conditioning as well is that we shouldn't have difficulty. We shouldn't ever be afraid. We shouldn't have sorrow, whatever it might be. And so it takes a lot just to remember, okay, this is the truth of the present moment. This is what's happening right now. And to look into it rather than feel ashamed of it or something has gone wrong. And I often do tell the story of I am still, as you can tell from other things I say, still quite close in many ways to many of the people I sat my first retreat with in January of 71. And I'm somewhat famous amongst that group of people for having once marched up to Goenka, who was the teacher, and looking at him and saying, I never used to be an angry person before I started meditating, thereby laying blame exactly where I felt it belonged, which was on him. I mean, clearly it was all his fault. And he just laughed, and, you know, of course, I'd been a super angry person before I started meditating, but I hadn't been in touch with it. And so in that process of looking within, I think really with any kind of introspection and getting more closely attuned to just the range, the wealth of what we feel, it was coming up. It took some time before I realized that's okay. You know, now let me be with it in a different way, so that there's as much as possible more balance looking at it, more awareness, more clarity, more kindness, more compassion, right? So it's not wrong, even when things are difficult, it can be very useful. That is the ground out of which compassion will arise, is being in touch. There's also, there's a question of balance there as well. Because remember what I said quite a bit earlier in the retreat, I didn't see, at least my understanding of the Buddhist teaching, that suffering itself is not redemptive. It's how we relate to the suffering that opens us and brings us together, potentially, and is transformative. So, you know, to sit and just suffer is kind of not the point. But to be continually, creatively molding our relationship to that suffering is the point. And sometimes that means...
Sorry, I missed that.
What'd they say? I couldn't hear them.
Sorry, I missed that.
I missed that?
Sorry, I missed
that. Am I being recorded? Okay, I'll say it again. Sometimes it means taking a break. I was teaching here once, very early on, in this very room with Joseph Goldstein. And all of a sudden, out of the speakers, like some distant radio or something started playing. So it was really like an alien. And we were just like, I don't know how that happened. So it picked up something. So anyway. So, yes, where's my train of thought? Let me say it again, a different way. I would remember again and again that this is about relationship. And it's not about, you know, sitting there with your teeth grit trying to endure. I talked a little bit about my teacher, Saida Upandita, the Burmese teacher that we brought to IMS in 1984. So we brought him, never having met him before, but hearing that he was this wonderful teacher, and I and many of my friends were sitting this three-month intensive silent retreat under his guidance, which began the day after he arrived. And he is a wonderful teacher, and he also turned out to be really tough and very, very fierce and strict and demanding. If you trusted him and you got along with him, it felt like he was asking you out of his confidence in you to hold nothing back. And, you know, you can do it, and, like, you can do more. And if you didn't have that relationship to him, it was really hard. And I happened to have a very good relationship to him, but still, you know, it was like, he was very tough. So one day, he was doing a question and answer session in the hall, and somebody said to him, how long should I pay attention to physical pain before I move my attention to something that's easier to be with? Listening to sound, maybe loving kindness, something like that. Depends on what method you're using, but how long should I be with the physical pain before I start paying attention to something that's easier to be with? And I thought, given his personality, he was going to say, you should be with the pain till you fall over. I honestly did. And to my astonishment, he said, don't be with the pain that long. He said, be with the pain, move your attention to something that's easier to be with. Go back to the pain if it's still there. Move your attention to something that's easier to be with. He said, it's not wrong. Just be with the pain and be with the pain and be with the pain, but you'll likely get exhausted. So he said, why not build in balance all along the way? And I was sitting there in the room thinking, wow, if those words are coming out of his mouth, that must really be true. Because he's like the farthest thing in the universe from someone who would say something just to be nice. Right? So that's an interesting reflection, the way we can get kind of over-heroic and think, okay, I'm going to break through this and forget. It's like with compassion, sometimes you have to look at joy too, right? And not only its suffering. Sometimes we have to intentionally look for the good, just for balance sake, things like that. But this is not cowardice, you know, this isn't saying it's wrong to feel these really difficult things and I'm not strong enough. We are strong enough, but we also titrate, right? There's a rhythm that we develop. So it's genuinely being with and in a healthy way, opening to what's difficult without feeling so overwhelmed. So a lot comes back to this sense of balance, which is not a formula, unfortunately. You know, a lot of it is really what we sense, or if you're working with a teacher, what they sense. You could try a little harder or, you know, relax. Upandita generally was like, try a little harder. But not always, right? And so we find our way, and the bottom line is that really any experience is okay. We're just gonna work with being with it as skillfully as we can. And the beautiful and wondrous and great openings will happen. For almost everybody, some really difficult things will come up, inevitably. And there tends to be a fair amount of time in just a sort of neutral zone. It's like just another breath. Oh yeah, okay. Not very pleasant, not very unpleasant, but this is the mirror of our day, of our lives. We have pleasure, we have pain, we have neutrality, all experiences changing. We can't control the flow of events. We can be tremendously empowered by how we relate to what is happening. And when things are difficult, it can be the doorway to compassion. When things are, when they feel wonderful, it can give us that sense of richness or abundance instead of like avoiding those times or not taking those in. And when things are neutral, which is tends to be a fair amount of time, we can wake up and we can feel connected rather than so sort of numb and just waiting for something better to happen. So I'd really encourage you to sit every, it doesn't have to be sitting, but we say that sort of as shorthand, sit every day, at least 7 minutes. If you can, and if you can't, honestly, I think it's better to do the 2 minutes than not at all. And because that's the magic moment. Same venerable old Lama who said short moments many times, said once, the most important moment of your meditation practice is the moment you sit down to do it. Because in that moment, we're taking something maybe we value tremendously and we're working to make it real. Right in that moment. Whatever it then feels like, that's the moment where we've laid claim to some sense of possibility. Okay, I think that's it for me for now. I wondered if you wanted to say something, you and Brooke, if you wanted to say goodbye in some way or if you... Brooke probably doesn't.
Here comes the mic.
Do you want a microphone?
Go get the mic. You want to come sit up here? Come on.
We'll sit on the ground because we love the ground.
I do too. Okay.
We were just talking yesterday about how much we, I hope that a lot of you noticed this in the yoga classes, how we do work right off of what the two of you are teaching. So much of the yoga comes right from ancient, it does come from ancient India. It comes from the same practice of and curiosity of what is reality, that big question. And we just thank you so much. If you knew how much we talk about you in our classes, we're always quoting Sharon and Bob. And allowing that that whole balance of awareness, mindfulness, and using the asanas to create balance. And it's just a joy to teach. And I wanted to say also, it's just so wonderful to see people come back. A lot of us have been coming back year after year, and we hope to be all back next year. And some people are bringing their buddies, which is even greater. There's a very warm feeling. This has been an incredible group. Every retreat is very different depending on who comes. And I just wanted to say thank you all for coming, and it's been really great.
Yes, also, this has been a wonderful group, and it's so inspiring to teach after hearing each of you speak and having that material to then fill the teaching of the asanas and the pranayama. But I think of a story of a young man who wanted to become enlightened and went off to the caves. Of course, it was India or Tibet. It wasn't in Chicago, but it could have been. But He went off and he just couldn't meditate. He was so restless and his body wasn't in good condition. So he couldn't sit and he couldn't sit. And apparently a cat came by and began stretching and putting its leg behind its head, you know, doing its things. And he saw this and realized that if you could make your body more fit, you could sit better. And so it's the story is, and I think this was probably in a book for people who love cats, because I'd never heard it any other time, but that the asanas were really created so that people could sit longer, so they'd be stronger, so that their muscles along the side of their spine would allow them to sit. And then also so that their mind would be quieter because they had concentration and they had something to focus on, and that then they could be compassionate toward themselves and they could have loving kindness for themselves and the world. So that's the story. And I feel like everybody here really understood what we were doing, all everybody. I just heard conversations all the time where people were really grasping the teachings. So it's been a wonderful time. Thank you.
And Paul, did you want to say anything?
Oh, yes, please. Sorry, I'd like to. It reminds me of one of my lamas that ideally you hope to have in meditation the ability to have pliability in mind and body for 4 hours. Is that the goal? That you could have pliability of mind and body?
Well, the word I think. It's prashabdi, it's meaning in the flow. Mm-hmm. And some people translate it pliancy and pliability. I prefer fluency.
Fluency,
because prashabdi means to flow, you know. So prashabdi means superflow. So yeah, that's a particular state of concentration, one point in mind, where your body and mind feel very lifted in a certain way. If you have a certain type of bliss, which is not the super bliss, but it's a type of very powerful bliss that enables you to concentrate. So that's what that person is referring to.
Good morning. It's working. Good morning. Though for some of us, good morning began at 7 o'clock this morning. So I love the idea that every year there's like this whole different group of people, some the same, but like a new kind of crop, if you will. And I also am very much inspired by a daily practice. So to have an annual gathering can inspire, but then hopefully to kind of immediately go back and to integrate it into some sort of a daily practice. And the idea that to be so inspired by what Bob and Sharon would say, and then for us to have this opportunity to kind of create a kind of a physical vessel that could kind of contain physically, emotionally, mentally, spiritually, all of this, so that you really then just have this greater capacity to actually go out and do all this stuff. And then also be able to dance until like midnight at night, and then show up the next morning at 7 o'clock. So it's a very special time, and I just, it's only been a few years I've been doing this. It's been a long time, but it doesn't get any better. So thank you guys so much, you know.
Thank you, Paul. That's good. That's interesting. What?
It's you, but
okay.
Pull that, brought this book up here so I could just.
What then? Yeah.
Yeah. I've always wanted someone to write the story of like our time in India, you know, just that wave and what were the factors. And someone has actually written that book, not about the Buddhist community, but about the community around Neem Karoli Baba, or Maharaji as he's called, who's Ram Dass's guru, Krishna Dass's guru. And so this is the book, Love Everyone, which is really a fabulous book, and it's really fun to sort of live through those times again, even though it was a sort of somewhat different direction or path, and just to remember that kind of movement, that tremendous sense of seeking and possibility and discovery. And I think Alexander, the astrologer, said something like, those are these, like these times, or that time is coming again, right?
More intense.
So I just kind of said, that sounds really good to me. That part of it anyway. So it's okay. Your...
what to say, what to do. It is really nice to be here. I think maybe we have to celebrate a little bit the place. You know, this valley is this amazing place that for the last 40 years or 50 years, it has been a center of people discovering themselves, actually. And then when the grandmothers came here, that's one of the wise women from the Native American people, I think from the Onondaga tribe, which is one of the six tribes, six nations of the Great White Tree of Peace, the Daganoweda, Iroquois Confederacy, I think it's called sometimes, all here in this area of New York State up into Canada, of the native people who are here, Algonquin, Iroquois, Mohawk, Tuscarora, Onondaga, Seneca, Mohawk, I think, whatever, I don't know how many that is. Anyway, she said that the spring that gives the water to this place coming out from under what they call Panther Mountain, but I think someday in the future it will be called Menla Mountain, actually. Mountain of the healing enlightenment. And was always holy to the native people who never lived up here. They only came up here for retreats, for vision quests. They also exposed the dead on those high platforms, which was their way of dealing with the dead bodies, giving it back to the animals, you know, in nature. And they hunted and they gathered, you know, nuts and herbs and things. But they never lived in this. And this whole area was a primeval hemlock pine tree forest from here to Woodstock and all around in these areas. And then underneath this particular place where you have this circular stream over this meteor strike, great giant crater that used to be here 400 million years ago, radiating some kind of magnetic something. It is really a place of great blessing. A treasure is here, you know. And then that's why there's a great dragon, serpent dragon, Naga here that the Dalai Lama met when he came here. And the Dalai Lama said, actually, when he, you know, when I went to greet him, I think you heard the story, at the little snow lion house up here, which we fixed up specially to be his house. He said he had in the morning a big bowl of milk he was offering. Huge bowl, must have been a gallon and a half of milk in it. And I said, what's that, Your Holiness? He said he was offering to the Naga. He said, you have one really big Naga here, he said, very huge, powerful Naga. And I said, oh dear, I hope it didn't disturb your sleep. He says, no, he said, I had the best sleep I ever had in North America, he said. And he's been everywhere in North America, actually. He's been really all over the world. And then he recommended a certain puja that we do, which involves offering milk to the underground, underwater, you know, Naga spirits, who actually are very disturbed in America nowadays by fracking, I think, because fracking poisons the earth underneath in a very bad way, you know, putting the poison water back in and this kind of thing. So I think the Tibetans never even caught fish in the rivers because they thought it would displease the Nagas, because the fish somehow represented these underwater beings. So they never ate fish, ever. Tibetans didn't. And the rivers were teeming with fish. Chinese went nuts when they got there catching the fish. So it's a great blessing to be here together in this wonderful sort of little hidden valley, what the Tibetans call a beyul, a hidden valley, like a Shangri-La Valley, you know, where you go into the valley and you're closed in from the world in a sort of emptiness womb of compassion, I think. Shunyata karana garbham. We should put that over a gatehouse if we ever build a gatehouse. Shunyata karana garbham. I think we will. Maybe in English too. So finally, what's coming in my mind about carrying on, you know, keeping alive the retreat, calm and peacefulness and happiness, and compassion toward others in the, you know, when you're not on the retreat. What always comes back to me is the Eightfold Path, you know, the Fourth Noble Truth. But then there's the issue of Buddhism, and I want to also mention that there's another element about the place now. I think somehow it is encased in His Holiness the Dalai Lama's consciousness. And sort of this is his retreat place in America, like Tibet House is his cultural center in America. Nina and I sometimes get tired of managing it, and we're in our mid-70s now. Nina will be 75 on Friday. And I'll be 75 a few months later. And sometimes we whine to His Holiness and we say, wouldn't somebody else like to take care of Tibet House? And Menla, he says, no, you have to keep working. He says, he never lets us off the hook. So somehow we're in his hands, you know, here in a way. His presence is kind of here. He was teaching this time in South India. And I had letters from people, and he was very much glowing, and he was very, very happy. And he gave a lot of talks to people, thanking them for coming, similar like to what we're doing this morning. It's interesting. But the one key thing is he never wants people to be Buddhists. Even he wants you to know about Eightfold Path of development, Eightfold Path to freedom, to nirvana, to happiness, to freedom from suffering. But you don't need to be Buddhist to do that. He's against making people Buddhist. And he also has spoken to the leaders of all the other world religions, various popes, archbishops of Canterbury, Protestant ministers, Hindu swamis, Muslim, you know, mullahs and imams and people. And he's asked them, he particularly likes the Jewish people because they don't try to convert people unless you marry into a Jewish family or something. They have a little fuss about, the Orthodox people do. But otherwise, they don't try. And he thinks that's very important at this time of history, that people encourage followers of other traditions, including secular humanism, which he considers a world religion, which I am a little bit, about the nihilistic view, I'm a little more critical than he is. But he tells me to shut up when I get into it anyway. So he considers that a world religion. And he feels that it's a time of pluralism in every city, in every country in the world. And there's people from every tradition, and therefore, you cannot have religious institutions competing for market share, you know. It's a really bad thing. Like, just that morning on the news, they were talking about the Saudis just murdered or executed a Shiite, very moderate, nice Shiite cleric who was a Saudi Arabian. And they executed him because he was critical of the royal family and of the Wahhabi extremism, of the form of Sunni extremism. And they had the gall and the cruelty and the stupidity to execute him. So he feels this is not a good time. The time in history is past. And that's actually a really good sign that he says that, because actually in the prophecy of Shambhala, when Shambhala comes on earth, which is the Buddhist sort of post-Armageddon New Jerusalem idea, you know, from Kalachakra Tantra, one of the phenomena is that all the world religions get along, and they don't compete each other. And they see that it's possible through whatever path for people to reach freedom of some sort. You know, like Nirvana, there's no, you don't have to have a special membership card to reach Nirvana. You know, you can be a Jew Boo, Chris Boo. I mean, you can even be just a Jew or a Muslim or whatever. You don't have to be a Boo at all. Forget about the Boo. But maybe the Eightfold Path as the core of a kind of curriculum remains important, actually. And there can be an Eightfold Path in connection with any tradition, although theologically or philosophically, that may involve some critical thinking. You know, for example, no one, as His Holiness says, he recently said, actually in an interview I did, he said, he never says Buddhism is the best for everyone. For himself, he thinks it's the best. And that's, people are allowed to do that about their own tradition. But he never says it's the best for everyone. On the other hand, as science, you know, what is the nature of the psyche? You know, what is the nature of the atom? What is the nature of the environment? What is the nature of the cosmos? There can be arguments about that. And he's quick to reject the old Indian cosmology that Buddha didn't contradict in his time about Mount Meru, you know, the axial planetary axis was a mountain and the different continents stuck off in flat. It isn't that the Earth was flat, it's that the continents, like Eurasia, was a flat petal that stuck off the mountain. But the mountain was a big lump like this with sun and moon, you know, that would go around it and so on, the stars. But it was terracentric. So he loves to say how he disagrees with that. And he's brave enough to disagree with Buddha, catering to the local Indian science. So in science, there is a kind of, in dealing with reality, there is a right and wrong. And there has to be critical analysis. And there has to be competition of thought and reasoning. In reason, there has to be. And he is an advocate of reason. So in a way, there is a way of converting people to be reasonable, you know, within conventional parameters of reason. I mean, reason is not ultimate. It's about the relative, but still, there is a reasonable thing. So let's go over, just summarize, since you know what it is, the Eightfold Path. To carry with you the Eightfold Path. Sharon is encouraging you 9 minutes and 7 minutes to change your brain. And that's very correct and very good. And that's the seventh branch of the Eightfold Path, the mindfulness branch. And then the loving kindness comes as a really from some of the earlier branches. So let me summarize them. Let's think through them together. The first branch of the Eightfold Path, best translation of it is realistic worldview. And its opposite is unrealistic worldview. So this beginning of one's practice, and all of it is all of the Eightfold Path is practice, or as I prefer to call it, performance. I'm tired of practice. I like people to perform. I myself have been practicing a lot, and I'm still useless and hopeless. And luckily, I still my kind wife is kind enough to continue to try to correct me, and I've made a little progress. But I still need to perform, actually, not just to practice. So the first performance is to correct any unrealistic element in one's worldview. And here, this doesn't mean believing in God or believing in Buddha or believing in this or that or not believing in it. In a way, it's like belief, but it isn't really belief. It's a worldview. It's how you look at the world, how you kind of reasonably decide and realistically decide to look at the world. And the key thing that requires a kind of acknowledgement or acceptance, or you could say belief, you know, but it's really how you view things, is a belief in causation. Isn't that surprising? Buddha's great only demand on people in the sense of being reasonable was to urge them, as the beginning of their practice, to accept, to acknowledge, to be aware of causation. So his great celebratory verse about his teaching is Om Yed Dharma Hetu Prabhava, hetun tisham tathagata hiyavadat tisham jayo nirudo ivamvadi mahasramani swaha. So all thing, of all things that arise from causes, what are the causes and how they are terminated or ceased? This is the teaching of the great seeker, Mahasramana, the great wanderer, the great seeker. His famous verse. And what does it mean to accept causation? If you correct your worldview from the unrealism of your thinking of yourself as being a point of unchanging permanent selfhood, independently established in the center of your being, somehow coming out of itself and not being constantly connected to a process of causation and therefore changing, and therefore being itself a cause of other things and being itself the effect of other causes. That sort of uncaused self, that's kind of your absolute you, the real you. The realistic worldview about causation automatically helps you to correct that feeling of yourself as this absolute thing. Do you follow me? Which is the very first step in practice or performance. It's the medicine. You know, it's the contradiction to that kind of thing that people say when they're losing their temper. And you say, well, come on, why do you have to blow your stack now or something? And then they say, because that's just the way I am. Right? That's just me. You know, they say that. You know how people do? I mean, you know how you do? I know how I do. And that's where they bump into this unrealistic thing that there's something there that's just a fixed thing a certain way. And of course, when they're on, the upside of the manic cycle of the unenlightened psychotic, then that's an absolute thing, it's like whatever. And when they're on the downside, then they're deeply depressed because they think that unchanging fixed thing is something unworthy, something awful, something whatever, you know, all the put downs they've ever received in this life and previous lives. And also acceptance of causation means there cannot be any first cause. Things, every cause is itself the effect of something preceding it, which then opens up one's horizon to the beginninglessness, the infinity. So for example, if one is a theist, it opens one to the infinity of God. You can't say that God just sort of at one point out of nothing made something, because God was the something that he made it out of, who's infinite. So it involves maybe reinterpreting. Similarly, Big Bang for the materialist cannot be out of nothing. It's out of previous Big Crunch. So this beginninglessness becomes a way in which one's connection to those things opens up. Once one adopts and accepts the realistic worldview that all is relative, all is causal, all is causation. Okay? But then there's an element of what is uncaused, not caused, which then also is beginningless, also is infinite nirvana, but let's not push that right now. Main thing is because we're in the relative world, we're dealing with life, and we open our mind to causality. And this gives great combination of great freedom and great responsibility. With the great freedom comes the fact that there's no fixed way of being. So we can never be that bad, and we don't have to be that good. We can always just baby step it. Like one of the things I assigned as homework, which is to watch the movie, What About Bob? Which has nothing to do with me. It's the teaching of Bill Murray and Richard Dreyfuss. If you haven't seen it, you should rent it and see it. What About Bob? Baby steps, bit by bit. One is always doing something bit by bit. One is cultivating, realizing, developing positively bit by bit. Or one is going down the drain bit by bit. So one can catch hold at any point. So that's the freedom. And then the responsibility is that if you don't catch hold of your causal process, of your constantly changing relative selfhood, apart from any fantasized absolute self, then yourself will be changed automatically by circumstance. And it will go where you haven't actually planned to go. But that's the first step. Then the second step of the Eightfold Path is called realistic motivation. Sometimes intention, people like to translate. But like motivation. So realistic motivation, once you have adopted causality and you realize you're a causal process, once you have adopted that, then your motivation is that you should associate yourself with all good causes. And you should reduce the connection to negative causes. And you are an evolving being, and you should develop the motivation to use your time of being conscious and having your will of choosing, your free choice, to whatever extent you have it, by however aware you are, so that you're motivated always to choose the positive, even if it's the tiniest little thing. And my always favorite example is always Shantideva's great thing, where he says, when people ask me where to go, where's lunch, where's the conference center, where's the yoga center, I never will point to it with one finger, which has a subliminal quality of bossing them and being superior to them, like I know they don't, pointing there, you go there. It's like a commanding aspect to it. Instead, I will gesture toward where they should go if they ask me with my whole hand, like you invite an honored guest to go somewhere. And you'll say, there's the yoga center. There's the conference center. There's lunch. There's the bathroom, whatever it is. So the difference between pointing with your finger like this or inviting with your hand like that is a tiny thing. It's almost a subliminal thing in communicating with other people. But it's immensely powerful. And your motivation is to always choose the slight increment that's better as opposed to the increment that's worse, or just let it go without noticing. So then the third step is realistic evolutionary action. Kamanta. Samyak kamanta. And action has three levels: physical, verbal, and mental. And realistic actions are not to harm or take life, not to kill, harm, or take life. Not to take what is not given to you, but to give whatever you can, to save life. You know, there's always a negative side and a positive side. Anything in the direction of saving life is realistic because it connects you with the larger life. You identify with more life when you save it. When you take it, you say that life is not connected to me. I can take it away from that other person. And you take life, you save life, you don't take it. You give things to others, you don't take what is not given to you. And then with sexual contact, you never harmful in the sexual area and always beneficial and caring. And then that can be identified in different cultures, different ways. So those are the three physical. And always what's realistic about them is that they tend to expand your sense of life rather than contract it, so that you broaden your feeling of you live in other people as well, in other beings as well as in yourself. And unrealistic is where you narrow down and say, I don't have anything to do with these other people. And of course, that's why sexuality is mentioned, because that's where normal biologically people do open up to each other. And to use that in a harmful way, where you're in a way closing off from another and just using them as an object in some way, that's considered very unrealistic. Then there are four verbal: tell the truth and not to tell a lie, to speak reconcilingly, making other people friendly with each other and making peace between other people, or causing dissension among them and slandering them to get them turned against each other. That's unrealistic. Speaking pleasantly or speaking harshly. Harshly is unrealistic, it drives people away. Pleasantly is attracts people and embraces them, and that's realistic. And finally, speaking meaningfully, which means trying to give others better understanding and insight and happiness and pleasure through speech, or just blabbing mindlessly without knowing what you're talking about, frivolously and foolishly, without any meaninglessly. Those are four of speech. And again, the realism and unrealism has to do with how much you embrace and enfold the other being. And of course, loving kindness versus unloving harshness totally, of course, relates very much to speech, because speech is considered karmically so important, evolutionarily so important, because speech is social. Speech is how you interact with other beings. It's your daily constant interacting. You listen to others, you speak to them, you inhabit each other's minds through speech. So using speech realistically, express being in your speech realistically is so crucially important, not unrealistically. And then, and this is then where meditation comes in, of course, already in ethics. You can be unethical and you can have negative evolutionary action through your mind. And it's sort of parallel to the physical. You can be malicious and hateful. Even you're looking, smiling, and nice, you're thinking negative thoughts about someone. Or you're having loving thoughts about them. And these powerfully interact with others, actually. So you're, even though you're not saying anything bad, you're not physically doing anything bad, if you're mentally thinking bad, it's bad evolutionary action. And even that's considered more powerful than the physical or the verbal, because it motivates the physical and the verbal. And it also communicates directly through morphic resonance. So the three negative, unrealistic evolutionary actions of mind are hateful mind, greedy mind, and unrealistic mind, coming back in a way to the first thing of realistic worldview. And so hateful is obvious versus loving, greedy versus generous, or detached and generous, and realistic versus unrealistic. Then following on realistic action, evolutionary action, comes realistic speech, which is in a way also included there, but it's emphasizing the importance of speech, that's all. So I don't need to repeat what it is. And then realistic livelihood. So don't think that your livelihood is not related to your practice and your performance. It is. It doesn't mean you have to quit your livelihood, although people became mendicants in cultures that supported that, because all livelihoods have some little bit destructive. Even if you're a vegetarian and you have a garden, you're killing insects by plowing and planting and weeding and so on. And so that's why the Jains, for example, never could do agriculture, because of the plants, you know, they were worried about heart, but also the insects. So whatever it is, the livelihood should follow the evolutionary action realistic path and should try to be minimize harm and maximize benefit. And actually, in the new kind of corporate mood or insight that is coming up, going past a kind of veneer of social corporate responsibility, you know, there's a new one where the corporation has a wider branch of stakeholders, and the, like my friend Mark Benioff, the 1-1-1, you know, to nonprofit, 1%, 1%. Although Nina thinks it should be 10%, 10%. But still, 1% is very good, instead of everything to the shareholder. And realizing that, Buddha actually liked business. He liked merchants. He was a warrior class person. But he preferred merchants, because merchants seek wealth and they seek prosperity by exchange, by interaction with others. So they are social It's a more social way of gaining wealth, and it gives something to the customer. If they're going to be a satisfied customer, they have to get something good that you create, and then they give you back what they created. And it's really very good. The military way, in contrast to the previous, before Buddha's time, the military way of gaining wealth, it seems to be really great because you get everything from the customer in one shot. But the problem is you kill your customer. So then you can't sell them anything next year because they're dead. So then you're all stuck, all isolated to yourself. So the mutual exchange and the increase of wealth by having both sides gain something, Buddha preferred, and in the history of Buddhism, it spread wherever merchant classes could spread their knowledge, actually, and spread that exchange. And in countries where the government controlled too much the merchant classes, it had difficulties. So that's realistic livelihood. Now, number six, then, is realistic effort. It's usually translated, or diligence, some people say. But it has a definition where it means diligence in the good. It doesn't. Someone can be an energetic murderer, or bank robber, or hedge fund manager, or banker robber, or whatever, and that's not considered realistic. So realistic, that's why I like to translate it sometimes, is creativity, creative effort, always making something better out of whatever it is, yourself and anything you touch or anything around you. And that's the sixth one. And that goes in general towards all levels. And so the first two are connected to wisdom, the next three are connected to ethics, and the sixth one is connected to all of them, realistic, creative effort in the good. And then number seven, I don't need to elaborate because it's Sharon's special expertise and mastery, and it is realistic mindfulness, which literally is the word memory, actually, smriti, sati. It literally means to remember, and that's crucial to know, realize that. And in a way, it's taking your memory, and instead of wandering in your sort of remembrance of past misdeeds and sufferings, it's remembering the present moment of what's going on right now. And instead of wandering into future fantasies and being mindful of those, you're mindful of the present, what's happening in your being, in your mind, and your activity right now. So that's a very important beginning of deepening your sort of mental realism about what you are and what your inner world, your inner processes, and gaining freedom in your inner processes rather than being driven by the unconscious. And this is the huge difference of Buddhist psychology, not a religious difference, a scientific one, and Western psychology. Because Buddhist psychology does not accept that you have to be unconscious and that you're going to be driven forever by a big sort of clump of unconsciousness. Yes, the ordinary, habitual, instinctual-driven person is driven by a huge unconscious. In that sense, Freud made a great discovery, of course. And it was, he deserves a kind of a place in the history of enlightenment because of that. But he argued that it was an inevitable sort of space, and that you always would be unconscious of it. You just vented it a little bit this and that way and didn't repress too much, and you sublimated, and et cetera, et cetera. But it was always there. Whereas the Buddhists do not agree with that. You can become conscious of your unconscious. That's what mindfulness is about, actually. It is becoming conscious of your unconscious. And the extreme level of being conscious of your unconscious is when you're becoming a Buddha. A Buddha is a being defined as a being who has no area of unconsciousness whatsoever. Completely conscious of all processes, all causal processes around the relative being, continuum of relative being that is a being, that is a living being. And so the goal is, the motivation is not have anything driving you. Don't be a slave to anything that you don't know what it is. Be a master of all energies that you're enfolded with. And Buddha's good news was you can do that. He succeeded in that. He was happy. He remembered all infinite previous lives by the time he was enlightened. He saw all of other beings' previous lives. In a way, that therefore there was no unconscious thing, no ancient unknown trauma driving him whatsoever. And of course, because realistic causality means there's no going into nothingness of anything. So therefore, there are always more effects. More causes give more effects. More causes give more effects. But when you're free to choose your effects, because you're conscious of all layers of causation, then you have no more unconscious rebirth. You have no more driven, imprisoned slavery to your own impulses rebirth. You're completely conscious. You only choose loving kindness to be your purpose of existence as any kind of relative being. That's your goal. And realistic mindfulness, therefore, is a humongous enterprise of going so deep into yourself that there's nothing unconscious driving you, but you can find and discover all of the things down there, and you can consciously sublimate them toward the good, every energy. So there's no energy that would be negative if it was driven by unconscious and controlled by ignorance, covered over by ignorance, therefore, could ever make you do anything harmful or cause you any harm or anyone else any harm. And then finally, the eighth branch, this then leads, when you get totally conscious of everything, you then develop total concentration, you know, realistic samadhi, realistic concentrative realization. And that means complete one-pointed fluency, pliability or pliancy, however you like to call it, carried to extreme, total degree of inconceivability, total enlightenment. And so that means that you really can, for example, when anger wants to arise reactively because of some stimulus that you're reacting to, then you're aware of all that mechanism in the unconscious, whatever it is karmically. Somebody does something to you, and you're unconscious in some past life, they did something. So you then react with fear and defensiveness and fury and so forth. And then there's a terrible situation. But that can't happen because you're so mindful. The mechanism of that, and also you completely see through the false memory having been mistakenly done in past, previous, many times. And you realize that it's all bliss anyway. And nothing can disturb your bliss. Blissful. It's just everything that happens is just a reflection in the mirror of what they call bliss void indivisible, or bliss freedom indivisible. So those younger teachers than us, they're just fine if they are fully mindful at all times and fully realistic in their worldview at all times and fully realistically motivated at all times and fully realistically evolutionarily acting in all times and fully realistically evolutionarily speaking in all times and fully realistically evolutionarily living and making a living at all times, and fully realistically being creative in their effort at all times, and fully realistically being mindful at all times, and fully realistically being one-pointed and concentrated in samadhi, and which means having given themselves to the fully, to the infinite universe at all times, then why meditate? Everything is total realism at all times for such a person. But if they think they can do that while catering to nihilistic materialism and thinking that we'll just be in the moment and what the moment is a rehearsal for not existing and dropping out and not being here and not being here now, but not being here, not now, not being here, not now, then, or not being not here, not now, that's it, then they're kidding themselves. And they should, they unfortunately, they should have some venerability for seniority. Never mind. That's wonderful. There are these young punks running around rebelling It's the freedom thing that is the greatness of our culture. The, of course, with the evil empire and blah, blah, blah. Noam Chomsky and such people say. But the greatness is some bodhisattvas were there, not only Thomas Jefferson, but Mrs. Jefferson and Sally Hemings and other people who got those uptight weirdos with their weird pantaloons and their strange hairdos and their weird things and their funny big noses and their undercooked white skin and got them to behave a little better and have an idea of freedom and an idea that human creativity will bubble up when people are more free and you don't have rigid caste systems and elitist oligarchies. You know, like shutting down the creative people who will be more rebellious and less obedient to the boring idiot authorities. So I'm more power to those punks. I like them. Yay. Except they make me mad if they give me a hard time, but I like them anyway. So that's it. You got the Eightfold Path now? And realistic is so good. There's old translations of right versus wrong is bringing it into the Western authoritarian thing. Oh, there's a bunch of rules. You have to be right, not wrong. No, that's not. It's you have to, what is right is what accords with reality. Because reality loves you, and if you, more you accord with it, the better you are. Ignorance is not bliss. Ignorance is the cause of suffering. Wisdom is bliss. Knowing what's there, you fit in with what the reality loves you. So there are infinite Buddhas loving you, absolutely everywhere. They're in every atom, they're everywhere. And all you have to, the more realistic you are, the happier you are. You know, the more fluent, the more pliant, the more pliable, the more fluent, the more flowing you are. Okay? So, what are we doing? I want to read something. Oh yeah, oh, House, you said I would do House to me. Now this book is called A Force for Good, and I actually didn't write it. In a way, it's the Dalai Lama's book, but our old friend Daniel Goleman wrote it. And he wrote Emotional Intelligence, and which was a bestseller thanks to him and Oprah and Linda Lentieri. And so he's a bestseller writer. And yet he wrote this without taking a penny for himself. And he gave all the funds for it to the Dalai Lama Trust, which is really very nice of him. And the subtitle is The Dalai Lama's Vision for Our World. And I like the book so much that I proposed to Tibet House Board that we give him the Art of Freedom Award, which we're going to do on February 5th, 9th, I forgot, whenever our concert is, and gala. And then I'm teaching a 17-part course on Wednesday evenings with guest professors, and Dr. Salzberg is teaching one of the sessions on the 17th of January, I think.
23rd.
Oh, 23rd. Oh, thank goodness. Yeah. Okay, 23rd of January. That's right. That's right. And there, and Mark Epstein is teaching one. Krishna Das is coming with me to teach one in May. And Elizabeth Pijoff, who is from one of these programs. And these programs of the Dalai Lama's that Dan writes up here, quoting the Dalai Lama at every page, you know, closely working with him, are these secular things which relate to the idea that Buddhism's way of trying to be of benefit to the world, to America and to the world, or to whatever, Saudi Arabia, if they would. He tried to go on pilgrimage to Mecca, but they didn't allow it. But he wanted to, the Dalai Lama. And is to offer its knowledge of the human being to reinforce the, any religion's culture or non-religious secular culture. And particularly because the Dalai Lama considers there's a 1 billion person world religion called secular humanism or materialism of people who have left any other religion. And that's in a way secular humanism is their religion. And therefore he wants to offer as a secular thing, you know, MBSR, mindfulness-based stress reduction, compassion programs he developed at Stanford, which Elizabeth Pijoff will teach. I think she's the one on the 17th or the 16th, the week before, or I think. or I forgot, but anyway, she's there somewhere. And and a lot of other kind of programs. And he's, therefore, he loves this dialogue with scientists. And he loves it, the fact that we can say, because of the kind of research that he's encouraged, Fryer, Richard Davidson, and Stan Goldman, and other people, other neuroscientists, that 9 minutes a day will change your brain in a positive way, increase the links and increase the control of reactivity and so forth. And 7 minutes a day of loving kindness will also increase your brain and give you a few more endorphins running around up and down your fingertips, and you'll have a few more endorphins running around. And since that's where our unrealistic faith in materialism is connected, then that gives us encouragement. And Dalai Lama, that's what it's about, this force for good. And the ethical things are there, and we'll talk about them. And of course, I'm talking about the Buddhist sources underlying them, simply to make them more like helpful and effective, but without promoting it as Buddhism, which is the Dalai Lama is very much against. Okay, so that's one housekeeping thing. Then I'm going to do a meditation of a prayer, dedication prayer, we'll close with. And the way I'm doing this, now don't get mad and say that you can't understand. Because, and I actually, if I'd thought of it properly, I would have Xeroxed it so you could read it. But what you're going to do is you're going to mentally pronounce it as I read it by being in meditative mode. Okay? So I will read it since I don't have copies. And I could do call and response. I'll do call and response, maybe, and only do part of it. That's what we'll do. You go in meditative mode and repeat line by line as I read the first. And to encourage you, the first 20 or so verses of this prayer, which is called the prayer or the vow. In Chinese, they translate this word pranidhana, which relates to prana, pranidhana. And dhana means to give, or it means to feed. And prani means having a prana. So it's a kind of energy formulation. But I never have decided. I can't decide. Tibetan is translated as munlam, which literally means path of prayer. Path of wish, which we translate as prayer. And the Chinese translated as vow. So when you make a prayer, you're making a vow. Or when you make a vow, you're making a prayer that you really want to make it come true or something like that. It's very hard to figure it out, what's the right word in English. Anyway, okay? So please repeat after me line by line in a quiet, meditative voice, okay? Although maybe, okay, we'll just do it that way. But no, maybe let me read one paragraph first. Sudana, which means good wealth, is the yuppie that I mentioned earlier, who has been traveling through this whole, especially the last third of this sutra, talking to different teachers, which are called Kalyana Mitras, virtuous friends. Yes. And I just read one short paragraph before we do the repeat, okay? Just to give you an idea of where he is. He traveled and contemplated in a land for an aeon, in another for up to as many as aeons as atoms in untold Buddha lands, without moving from that land. In each moment of consciousness, he entered infinite oceans of lands and developed sentient beings towards supreme perfect enlightenment. This continued as he gradually attained equality with universally good, Samantabhadra Bodhisattva, that is, in terms of the ocean of vows of practice of the universally good enlightening beings, equality with all Buddhas, equality of pervasion of all lands, equality of fulfillment of practices, equality of manifestation of the miracle of attainment of enlightenment, equality of voice and articulation, equality of power and expertise, equality of the enlightened state, equality of universal love and compassion, equality of the spiritual metamorphoses of the inconceivable liberation of enlightening beings. Then the great enlightening being, universally good, thus explaining courses of aeons, as many aeons as atoms in the untold Buddha lands in the succession of worlds, went on to make a vow or a prayer or a dedication. Okay, just to give you a kind of setting. Now I'll repeat by line. As many Buddhas as there may be in the world, throughout the 10 directions, throughout past, present, and future, I honor them all without exception, pure in body, speech, and mind, with as many bodies as atoms in all lands. I bow to all those Buddhas. With a mind directed to all Buddhas, by the power of the vow of the practice of good, in a single atom, Buddhas as many as atoms, sit in the midst of enlightening beings. So it is of all things in the cosmos. I realize all are filled with Buddhas. I laud all the Buddhas therein, expounding in all languages the qualities of all Buddhas with endless oceans of manifestations. With the finest flowers, garlands, musical instruments, perfumes, and parasols, the finest lamps and incenses, I make offerings to those Buddhas. With the finest clothes, fragrances, and mountainous baskets of aromatic powders, with the finest of all kinds of adornments, I make offerings to those Buddhas. Whatever be the best of offerings, I produce them for all Buddhas, by the power of devotion to the practice of good, I honor and serve all Buddhas. Whatever evil I may commit or have committed, under the sway of passion, hatred, or folly, bodily, verbally, or mentally, I confess it all. And whatever the virtues of beings everywhere, hearers, saints, self-conquerors, enlightening beings and Buddhas, in all that I do rejoice. And all the lamps of the worlds in the 10 directions, who have realized enlightenment and attained non-obstruction, I seek as guides that they may turn the supreme wheel of teaching. And those who wish to manifest extinction, I petition respectfully to remain for aeons as many as atoms in the land, for the welfare and happiness of all beings. By honor, service, and direction, by appreciating, seeking, and requesting exchange, I'm sorry, by appreciating, seeking, and requesting teachings, whatever good I have accumulated, I dedicate it all to enlightenment. May the Buddhas of the past be honored, as well as those now in the worlds of the 10 directions, And may those of the future be at ease, filled with joy, having realized enlightenment. May all the lands of the 10 directions be purified, supreme, and filled with Buddhas and enlightening beings at the Tree of Enlightenment. May all beings in the 10 directions be happy and well. May all beings' righteous aim be successful. May their hope be realized. As I am carrying out enlightenment practice, may I recall my lives in all states, in every lifetime as I die and am reborn. May I always transcend the mundane, learning from all Buddhas, fulfilling the practice of good. I will practice pure conduct, always free from defect. And now this verse I am reciting in honor of Lin Ha as a way of penance for my misunderstanding her question. I will expound the teaching in the languages of gods and dragons, in the languages of demons and humans, and of all living beings. Okay, now finally, by honor, service, and direction, by appreciating, seeking, and requesting teachings, whatever good I have accumulated on this retreat here at Menla, I dedicate to enlightenment for all. And I want to say one thing that I just have to say. I can never forget that the seat of enlightenment means Bodh Gaya. And our dear beloved Sharon, when she first went to India as a young girl seeking from going from Buffalo, I think,
I was in college.
To Bodh Gaya, India, to try to figure out what was going on in her mind. There she met a man who is very much unrecognized in the world called Kuno Lama Rinpoche, who was an Indian citizen of Tibetan cultural extraction from the Himalayas within India, who had the special teaching of love and compassion from Shantideva and Manjushri called the equal exchange of self and other. How to give up your self preoccupation and happily adopt other preoccupation or true altruism of the bodhisattva mind. And he gave to Sharon a seed of the Bodhi tree as the first thing almost that happened to her, I think, in India, according to the story. And I think, was that your faith book?
Yeah.
Faith book. And Sharon has made this seed so fruitful for the enlightenment of so many people. And she has been so kind to Menla, coming here year after year in this cold winter time of the Western New Year. And hopefully we'll continue to do so. And we are so appreciative and so thankful to you, Sharon.
Oh, thank you.
100%.
Thank you.
So thank you, Sharon.
Thank you.
I just want to say, and I dedicate the merit of that to everyone.
Thank you. Thank you for your brilliance.
Sharon.
Yes, thank you for my doctorate. Thank you for your brilliance, and thank you for your efforts when you weren't feeling so well.
It's okay.
It's not that easy.
I feel fine, just my voice. But maybe that's good, because it isn't loud and it's irritating as it usually is. It's a little more croaky. So.
Really, thank
mute.
You.
It's like putting a mute in the trumpet.
We would be standing out in a field right now if it weren't for Bob and Nina.
And of course, Nina, yes, Dr. Nina. We have a nice warm room here. Thanks to Nina. Yes, Nina, I have to tell you all a story because we need everybody's help, of course. We want you all to help us here. We need it because this has to be a community. And actually, recently we had a shaman here, a lady from California, who is a great shaman, actually. And she contacted the guide who used to teach through the medium of Eva Parakas, who was the lady of the Center for the Living Force and the Pathwork Center, which was two communities ago that had this place, which was then given to us free. We could never have bought this place. It was given to us by positive karma, you know, by some protectors or something, by a kind, generous woman from New York. And the morning that the call came giving us this place from this generous donor, just before our 60th birthdays, I woke up a little late. I was just back, I was jet lagged. I was back from Mount Kailash in India, in Tibet, rather. Should be India, but Tibet. And should be international, like all holy places, actually. And so I slept late, got up around 10 o'clock, jet lag. And then I was already up. She was a little bit a little bit roiled up, because she'd been working hard with our daughter to make a birthday party for me, a 60th birthday. So she said, "I had a terrible dream." And I said, "Well, what was that, dear?" She says, "Well, instead of enjoying our 60s relaxing and, you know, doing something pleasant here and there, we were working like dogs on some huge project. And you were climbing on the roof of a giant building. And you were hammering away, like, because I'm a carpenter. You were hammering and shouting at an architect. And worst of all, you weren't listening to me." "So, if anybody proposes any big project to you, say no." I said, "Yes, absolutely, dear, absolutely." This is why I think we received the gift in one phone call.
Right, it was like half an hour later, right?
Yeah, half an hour later, the phone rings. Well, actually, there were two phone calls. And our intermediary, lovely person, Harriet Beinfield, the great acupuncturist from California, she said, "Someone's going to call you, and you can finally get that place you wanted to have Tibetan medicine, to introduce Tibetan medicine in America." And I said, "What? What? I know, like, oh, never mind, that probably won't happen. But anyway, thanks." You know, so I hung up. Then the phone rings, and the donor is on the line and says, "Do you want the Pathwork Center in Phoenicia, which is 20 minutes from where we live in Woodstock, in Bearsville?" And I said, "Well, I know the place very well. I used to teach here, Book of the Dead and other things when it was owned by Pathwork Center. And, but you know, and of course I need a thing like that." I said, "But I have to say no because my wife told me to say no about any big project." And I think she was so pleased that I was listening to my wife, or pretending to, that I think that's why she decided. So then I said, "But wait a minute." And she says, "Really?" "Yes," I said, "I have to say no." And then I said, "Wait a minute, let me ask her again." So then I asked her, and she said, "Oh, damn it. I can't say no because it will be an asset of the Tibetans. But I will have to work my ass off for a decade or two decades to make it function for nothing without a thank you," she said. "But say yes." So then I said yes. So then we made an appointment. So I wasn't even taking it seriously. I thought, because a lot of people say we're going to do this and that, and they didn't do it. And for Tibet, you know, because it's hard to do things for Tibet. It's the invisible lost cause, the invisible lost people who supposedly don't exist. They're just Chinese of some kind, blah, blah, blah. So it's very difficult. And so I forgot what I was going to say. Never mind. So, yeah, so this place is where Medicine Buddha, you know, creates his mandala to help Shakyamuni Buddha by showing people that they can live happily and healthily, and they don't have to be constantly the victims of a disease care industry, and they don't have to eat the bad food, and they don't have to think bad thoughts, and reality loves them, including the plants and the grass and the insects and the air, and even the malaria bug loves you. And the malaria loves me. It's great for me. I have malaria now. I know about what Somerset Maugham meant in the British Empire, and I have a malaria. That's wonderful. No problem. I can have the shakes and drink gin and tonics. It's great. And no problem. It's all to the good. I'm getting rid of some terrible bad thing I did in some past life, horrible. I'm mad about something, having nice malaria is wonderful. So this is the vision, and we cannot do this by ourselves. We're getting old. Sharon has helped us so much, and we need everyone's help. So please try to think of what can be done to make this, you know, and actually the vision I had, which brought this forth, was Menla's, not just here, but West Coast, and finally in Tibet itself, all of Tibet being a medicine land. You know? And His Holiness's vision, it's really not mine, it's His Holiness. 1981, he told me, if Tibet were free under whatever political arrangement, doesn't matter, but free on the land, on the ground, then we want to be like a Switzerland for the people of the world. But of course, nearby, the people of Asia, all these polluted cities, all these difficult places, they come up into high, clean mountain air. They go to wonderful hot springs. There are so many in Tibet, mineral healing springs. They have the wonderful herbal medicine that the Tibetans have. And they live here happily with the yaks and the people and the Tibetan monks and nuns and mendicants. They become healing specialists. We have sanatorias, like Switzerland of Asia. That's his vision. So this is rehearsing for where all of Tibet will be that for the world. And so Tibet needs your help. Menla needs your help. And you are helping, and thank you so much for helping by coming this one time and practicing the eight, carrying with you the Eightfold Path in your life and livelihood as you go forward from now on. Om Mani Padme Hum. Thank you. Kuan Yin.
Thank you.
Now, silence.
Thank you so much, really.